Our first topic is going to be one of the most common dermatologic presentations that we find in the United States. Many of us have gone through this, especially during puberty. Our topic, obviously, being acne vulgaris. Now, the acne vulgaris here that you're seeing could be of different types. You could have pustules, you could have vesicles. So in terms of description, it could be all over the place. And notably, as I said, when we talk about pathogenesis, we'll be focusing upon the puberty years. Demographics. 80% of people seek medical care for acne in life. Take a look at this pie. 80% with acne vulgaris with demographics. It's the most common found in teens and early adulthood. So you're thinking about those pubertal ages. Let's take a look at etiology. It's multifactorial. Here, as soon as you hear about acne vulgaris, it's the fact that you're thinking about your androgens playing a role. And hence, adrenarche increases sebum production. Think about your patient, a teenager perhaps, going through puberty. And so therefore, at this point, there's going to be increased levels of hormones, especially our androgens. So during adrenarche, increases sebum production. Next, what happens? Well, then you have these comedones. Now, what's a comedone? A comedone is basically the type of lesion that you expect to see with acne. Now, you've heard of blackhead and whitehead. And if it's a blackhead, this would then mean that the comedone, so think about that lesion that occurs, and think of this kind of being like a volcano, please. And that would be the best description here. And if you've heard a blackhead, that basically means that here, the volcano has erupted. In other words, the comedone is now exposed. So the overlying skin, or the cover, has been now removed. And that, once it's removed, the inner contents of your comedone then gets exposed to the environment, resulting in oxidation. And this oxidation then causes what's known as blackish discoloration, and you call this a blackhead. Whereas a whitehead, as you can imagine, the skin then is intact over the comedone. And if it is intact, then please understand, what then appears upon gross examination is going to be a whitehead. So comedone formed due to accumulation of lipid and keratin in the follicular unit. Okay? So think about where you are, maybe perhaps on your face, and you have a follicular unit, which is now undergoing this type of accumulation of lipid and keratin. An important point here would be a bacteria known as Propionibacterium acnes. A particular bacteria that you want to make sure that you memorize, overgrow in abundance of such quote-unquote oil. And by oil, what are you referring to? That sebum and lipid accumulation within your comedone. The bacteria convert the sebum into fatty acids that elicit an inflammatory response. And as soon as you think about inflammatory response, then you know that you have your WBCs, such as neutrophils, that are going to come in. All part of your etiology, pathogenesis of acne vulgaris. Let's talk about the morphology. If you have an open comedone, what does that mean to you? Remember, you have that lesion that you're looking for, and instead of it being covered, it is now opened. So therefore, the overlying skin, or epidermis, is not intact. It's open. Once this type of exposure is taking place, the inner content of your particular lesion is now at risk for oxidation. And what is it going to do? It'll oxidize a keratin plug, and therefore, the coloration that it then gives or provides is a blackhead. Whereas, if the epidermis over the comedone remains intact, so now you have a papule without the oxidation, because now you don't have such exposure. And therefore, upon gross examination, it'll appear as being white. Now, you could have acne vulgaris, in which, unfortunately, it might get a little bit bigger. And so therefore, now you're thinking about a nodule. And these would then arise from the follicle, rupture, and may then cause an inflammatory type of dermis. You're getting the dermis involved with nodules. Then you have a more serious type of acne vulgaris, and called nodulocystic lesion. And this can then yield a systemic symptom, most often seen with teenager boys, or boys, teenagers that are males. Management. Topical antiseptics. Here, you want to memorize benzoyl peroxide. So here, what you want to do is try to then make your particular quote-unquote infection, if you want to call it as such. Remember, bacteria could also be involved. And so therefore, you try to keep things as sterile as possible. Antiseptics. It prevents the comedones and perhaps decreases bacterial count. Or antibiotics. Example, tetracyclines. Also, depends on anti-inflammatory properties. Most commonly, doxycycline may cause photosensitivity, keep that in mind. Or minocycline, that may cause drug-induced lupus, keep that in mind, for these type of tetracyclines. All tetracyclines can cause a condition or an adverse effect known as pseudotumor cerebri. And remember, this is a patient that is then going to present with headaches, and there would be measurement of increased intracranial pressure. Upon fundoscopic examination, there would be papilledema. On imaging study, there'd be nothing, because this is a pseudotumor. We talked about this earlier. Continue our discussion of management. Here we have our vitamin A derivatives. In other words, our retinoids. And we have tretinoin as being a drug. Prevents a comedome and may decrease the inflammation. Oral retinoid, known as isotretinoin, reserved for severe nodular cystic scarring acne. Remember now, you're talking about a nodule that has also taken on a cystic type of appearance and could also have systemic involvement. Remember those young teenage boys we were talking about most commonly may be seen with. Now, with that, you need to make sure that you have minimal type of scarring taking place. Something that you want to keep in mind with side effects. It is, as you know, with retinoids, a huge teratogen. Here also, as with tetracycline, pseudotumor cerebri could be a possible side effect, SE. Hyperlipidemia, because of accumulation of lipid. Keep all this in mind when dealing with retinoids and with tetracycline, the common denominator between the two drugs as an adverse effect, pseudotumor cerebri. As a differential diagnosis, now what we will do as we go through dermatology is rule things in or rule things out. So at this point, our topic is still acne vulgaris. Many of your skin conditions would be, well, they might look quite similar, huh? And so therefore, what kind of things do you want to know about as clinical pearls so that you can either rule things in or rule things out? Our topic here would be differential diagnoses of acne vulgaris. A differential diagnosis, our topic here is acne rosacea. I emphasize rosacea. Not acne vulgaris, but acne rosacea. Well, how do you know if a patient has a rosacea versus vulgaris? Usually with the rosacea, adult of Northern European heritage, maybe perhaps Scandinavian. You're going to look for a patient that has particular triggers, such as stress, spice, so on and so forth. Then, there's going to be erythema, specifically the flushing that you're going to find on the face, and hence the differential with vulgaris. There's going to be a background erythema, which is redness, but that's nonspecific. But then you have telangiectasia. We'll talk more about rosacea, and when we do, we'll talk about something called rhinophyma. And basically, you have a bulbous nose with rosacea and could also be associated with alcoholism. Not always, huh? Not always. And comedone is not a feature of rosacea. Our topic, differential diagnoses of acne vulgaris. Here are some clinical pearls so that you know that you're dealing with rosacea versus vulgaris. Other differentials, perioral, periocular dermatitis. These would occur in specific areas, may follow topical steroid use. Here we have monomorphic in its appearance and inflammatory papules without comedones. Once again, comedone would be more as a high in a differential, either blackhead or whitehead, as being acne vulgaris in that teenage population, and you're looking for adrenarche type of issues, right? Here, comedone is not present with your dermatitis of periocular or perioral type of lesion. A differential diagnosis for vulgaris would also be folliculitis. Allow the name to speak to you. So we're talking about the follicular unit, right? And with the follicular unit, you know that there's hair that is being also expressed. So therefore now, the follicle or the follicular unit is undergoing infection, the hair follicle. And related in many respects, absolutely. Now, Could you have follicle involvement with acne vulgaris? Sure you could. But with folliculitis specifically, it is an infection. Predominantly on the trunk and extremities, so it doesn't have to be on the face with folliculitis. Occurs at any age, may progress to what's known as furuncles, carbuncles, and abscesses, topics that we'll take a look at in due time. But at this point, please know that folliculitis, if not properly addressed, may go on to develop furuncles, carbuncles, or perhaps even abscesses of that entire region.